have you here with us. I do not welcome you as guests, but rather as a family. Each one has been connected to each other some way or the other. And this is what makes it special for this 300th year. We pray today that the presence of God would be felt by all of us and that each one would be closer to Him. Just a small announcement. Kindly put your mobile phones on silent so that it doesn't disturb. We all have the worship order, or we all have the note with us. We will be following that note, and instructions are given as and when required. As a part of this 300th year, we have various activities here in the church. This is one of them. We also are planning to have a grand celebration on the 6th of October. That is a Thanksgiving service, thanking God for all His privileges He has given us. And we would like to welcome each and everyone to be part of that service. The details are put on the notice board as well. Today, we would just bow our heads where we are seated, acknowledge God's presence, and then begin the program. Let us pray. You know our hearts, O Lord. You know our struggles and our challenges. May we find you as we seek you here today. May your presence be real to each one of us, and that none of us would go back without having an encounter with you. We commit each and everything that happens here so that it will be for your glory. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and a warm welcome to each and every one of you. We are happy you are joining us as we give thanks for the completion of 300 glorious years of St. Thomas Cathedral, the Mother Church of the Diocese of Mumbai. It was in the year 1676 that the foundations of this church were laid. Unfortunately, the work on the building stopped for lack of funds. It was only 30 years later when a young dynamic priest, Reverend Richard Cobb, was appointed as chaplain that things started to move. Funds were raised, and the walls of this glorious church literally rose like the proverbial phoenix. The church was completed in the year 1718. The Mughals were still ruling. We were about 75 years younger than the Taj Mahal. Some of the composers whose music you will hear today were still alive. And some, like Mozart and Beethoven, were not even born when St. Thomas's was completed. America was still a British colony, and the French Revolution would happen only 71 years later. Now that really puts things in historical perspective, doesn't it? Finally, in the year 1837, the Diocese of Bombay was founded when Bishop Thomas Carr was the first bishop. Sir Thomas Church was elevated to a cathedral, the mother church of the newly created diocese. This is where the Bishop of Bombay has his cathedra, Latin for seat. This evening's concert has been conceptualized as a kind of journey, a journey against the backdrop of sacred music. It is indeed a humbling thought that much of what we will hear and sing would have been done by countless generations who worshipped within these hallowed walls for three centuries. Hallelujah, Amen. These words of thanksgiving aptly sum up our emotions in this, the cathedral's tercentenary year. We are sure you're going to have an enjoyable evening.
Salve Regina. The Gregorian chant is the unison liturgical music used throughout the Western Church. Historically, it has been the principal music for the proper and ordinary Mass and for the daily cycle of the divine office. Most chants date from 900 to approximately 1100 AD. The Gregorian chant is named after Saint Gregory the Great, who, as the story goes, had it dictated to him by the Holy Spirit in the form of a bird. Chatty birds aside, we have been able to put across an ensemble of the most mellifluous voices from across the city. So be ready to be transported to a musical journey, a sacred musical journey, a journey of the faithful who, over the centuries, have made it a point to make sacred music art something for all of us to enjoy. Ladies and gentlemen, Salve Regina. following a career path familiar to many musicians today. Rather than become a priest, an option Palestrina considered several times, he married. And for good measure, he married a second time, a wealthy widow, which allowed him the freedom to be a musician. So extraordinary was his talent that in 1555, Pope Julius III appointed Palestrina a singer in the prestigious Sistine Chapel, something that was nearly unheard of a married layman. In 1571, he was elevated to the post of the choir master at St. Peter's Basilica and remained there until his death. I'm about to quote from the text of the Council of Trent, and it bears listening. The function of church music is not to delight the ears, but to strengthen the impact on the listeners towards a longing for heavenly harmony and the contemplation of the joys of the blessed. They should also banish from the churches, I repeat, they should also banish from the churches all such music which, whether by the organ or in singing, contains things that are lascivious or impure. This text had threatened to eliminate the glorious tradition of the Latin church music. It is said that Palestrina's composition, sung at the council, changed the minds and the hearts of the committee, and they admitted that such beauty could only uplift the soul. Sicut servus.
verses from the Gospel of John, words spoken by Jesus to his disciples, foretelling his own death and promising that God the Father will send to them the Holy Spirit, a comforter. The music is by the English composer Thomas Tallis. It is an example of Tudor music and is part of the repertoire of Anglican church music. This is the music Queen Elizabeth I would have heard when she worshipped in Westminster Abbey. Throughout his service to successive monarchs as organist and composer, Tallis avoided the religious controversies that raged around him following the Reformation. He stayed an unreformed Roman Catholic. The popularity of this gem of church music received a boost in recent times at the wedding of Prince Harry and Meghan at St. George's Chapel, Windsor, last May. If Ye Love Me by Thomas Tallis.
Now we join in singing a rousing arrangement of the well-loved hymn, All People That on Earth Do Dwell. The text of this hymn is Psalm 100, hence the name of this tune, which is sung Old Hundredth. This arrangement is by Vaughan Williams. He wrote it for the coronation of Queen Elizabeth II. It's a marvelous ceremonial piece, and if it was fitting to be sung at Westminster Abbey in 1953, why not now at the St. Thomas's Cathedral on the occasion of her tercentenary? The congregation is invited to join in singing the verses as indicated.
People that on earth do dwell.
is the beginning and end of all music. This quote by the composer Max Reger probably sums up best what most consider true of the great genius. Bach wrote almost all his music for the daily services of the churches where he was appointed organist and choir master. Unlike his other famous contemporary Handel, Bach never left his native Germany, and his fame grew after his death as his works were published and circulated. This evening, we hear a sample of two works. The first is a delightful soprano and alto duet, here sung, as Bach may well have, by the full soprano and alto chorus. We hasten with weak yet eager steps, O Jesus, Master, to you for help. The second is the perennial favorite for many, Jesu, joy of man's desiring. Thank you.
Thank you.
period of music referred to as Baroque, a term also used to denote an architectural style which is extravagant and highly ornate. The word Baroque is a Portuguese term for a pearl, Baraco, with an irregular shape. This ornate and highly decorative style is on ample display in any music ranging from the mid-17th century to the 18th century. This was the century which saw the completion of our beautiful St. Thomas. George Frederick Handel would have been 33 years old when our church was completed in 1718. It goes without saying that the one universally recognized work is his ever popular Hallelujah Chorus. This evening, we get to hear another Hallelujah Chorus, this one from the oratorio Judas Maccabeus, composed in 1756. The tune of this ever popular hymn sung at Easter, Thine Be the Glory, incidentally comes from this oratorio.
Mozart is one of the world's most remarkable musical geniuses. Mozart's religious music is actually the least important part of his output. His relations to the church were troubled, and unlike Bach, he lived in a milieu where the profoundest ideas of the time were not practiced in church. At the same time, there are remarkable, profound church works that will never be forgotten. Solemn Vespers was the last liturgical work Mozart wrote for his taskmaster employer, Archbishop Colloredo, the Prince Archbishop of Salzburg. An authoritarian, autocratic ruler, the Archbishop demanded economy and efficiency in his church services and in the music created for those services. For example, the Mass was to be no longer than 45 minutes. Vespers is the Christian late afternoon, early evening service held traditionally around twilight. It is part of the Divine Office, a series of 8 daily prayer services held at different times of the day. Mozart composed 2 settings of the Vespers. This service is composed of 5 psalms, followed by a canticle, the Magnificat. This evening, we hear the second last movement, Laudate Dominum. The text is from Psalm 117. Mozart creates one of the most lyrical and beautiful soprano solos in all of his compositions. It is a gentle hymn of praise with soaring expressive melody for the soloist, accompanied by liquid, flowing instrumental lines. The chorus enters quietly at the Gloria.
The heavens are telling, Haydn. The classical period in Western music lasted from approximately 1750, the year in which Bach died, to 1827, the death of Beethoven. The period is called classical because in the arts there was a keen interest in, admiration for, and emulation of the classical heritage of ancient Greece and Rome. Incidentally, there was a thriving trade relationship between India and both these civilizations. Thomas the Apostle himself sailed to what is now known as the state of Kerala with the traders from the Roman Empire. At the height of this classical era, stand three composers, Franz Joseph Haydn, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, and Ludwig van Beethoven. The oratorio was a musical form, was popular in 17th century Italy, but mostly unknown in the country. It was Handel who reinvented the oratorio in London, giving it English words and making powerful choral music drama that was soon to dominate public Lenten music in 18th and 19th century England. After all, operas and plays were illegal during the fasting season, but what a musical feast. While Handel was in the Baroque period, during the classical period, Haydn became the most popular composer of English oratorios, and The Creation is his most popular work.
Thank you.
be on earth are listening. Beethoven is represented this evening with a tune universally recognized the world over. The words of the hymn, "Joyful, joyful, we adore thee," were written by Henry Van Dyke when he handed the hymn to his friend. Van Dyke said, "It must be sung to the music of Beethoven's hymn to joy." The melody of this hymn is best known for its use by Beethoven in the final movement of his superlative Ninth Symphony.
CPA and the Symphony Orchestra have been spectacular. So first, thank you. Second, I'm guessing probably all of us also need a stretch. So why don't you, for the next 30 seconds or so, stand up and have a stretch and take a little break. This is a very American thing. Go ahead, stand up. If you hire an American, you get an American. One of the things I do with the choir, which I'm going to subject you, I had to correct my own grammar mid-sentence, is a breathing exercise. So if you'll close your eyes, take a deep breath in over 4, I'll count, and then hiss it out over 8. Take a deep breath in, 2, 3, 4, hiss out, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There we go, let the rest go. One of the things we talk about is that the breath and the heart are the center of all music making, and that the heart powers the rhythm while the breath powers the phrasing. So that for every phrase we sing, we have both the constant rhythm of the heart, whether it's accelerating or slowing, and the breath shaping the big phrases. So have a seat, please. I bet the choir has had time to have a drink by now. I threatened to do a soft shoe, and then I thought better of it. Thank you again for your welcome. Choir, please come back. And we'll go on.
Locus Iste, Bruckner. Locus Iste was written in 1869 by the Austrian composer Anton Bruckner to celebrate the dedication of a chapel in the cathedral at Linz, where Bruckner had been the cathedral organist. The text is in Latin gradual, Locus Iste, for the annual celebration of a church's dedication. Most appropriate as we give thanks to this house of God, this sanctuary built 300 years ago. The music seems designed for a large building with matching acoustics.
Oh.
flat. The Te Deum is an early Christian hymn of praise. The title is taken from its opening Latin words, Te Deum Laudamus, rendered in English as We Praise Thee, O God. Written in 1879 for the choir of Trinity College, Cambridge, where he was an organist, C.V. Stanford, Te Deum in B flat was later used for the coronation of Edward VI in 1902. The music of Te Deum draws in its melodic shapes on Gregorian chant, but sparkles with the best energy of Anglican tradition. This is one of the best representatives of music for a daily service in the Anglican tradition. Te Deum in B flat.
Oh,
a nation give thanks to God for the life and leadership of Mahatma Gandhi. The Beatitudes in particular had a profound influence on the Mahatma. We now join in singing Abide With Me, a hymn which he loved and which is a perennial favorite of the Armed Forces Band and played each year at the beating retreat ceremony at India Gate, New Delhi. Delightful German Easter carol, Magdalene Cease from Sobs and Sighs, arranged by Peter Herford. The text of this carol implores Mary Magdalene to wipe away her tears and rejoice in the risen Lord.
Thank you.
Lennox Barclay. The anonymous 15th century English poem, which begins with the words, "I sing of maiden, that is makerless," is perhaps the best known of all late medieval lyrics, celebrating the Annunciation and the virgin birth of Jesus. The theme of the poem revolves around the term makerless, used to define Mary. The word has the double meaning of both matchless and mateless. The dew of these lines has rich symbolic associations in theology and biblical interpretation, being a common symbol of the Holy Spirit as well as of Christ descending to earth. April, the season of spring, is the time of renewal and rebirth, both spiritually and physically. The setting you will hear this evening is by the English composer Lennox Barclay, made famous by the choir of King's College, Cambridge, at their annual festival of nine lessons and carols at Christmas. The music has some strange sounding harmonies. See if your ears can pick them out. One of the best known composers of the 20th and 21st centuries. The immediate accessibility of Rutter's music, both tuneful and expressive, and its wide general appeal have earned him a place in the English musical tradition. Among his many pieces was one specially written for and sung at Westminster Abbey for the royal wedding of William and Kate. We hear now the words of the benediction, traditionally said at the end of a church service. This particular setting was written by Rutter for his alma mater, Clare College in Cambridge.
Mm-hmm.
We now join in singing the rousing Welsh tune set to the words, God of Grace and God of Glory. This is often sung at rugby matches by the Welsh team. Let's see if we can match their enthusiasm and exuberance.
We have one more thing for you that's not on the program. Because I figured if you have me, you might as well have some American music. Please enjoy. And if you know the words, sing along.
Thank you.
What a crescendo to end with. Super surprise, Slater. We couldn't have asked for more. But I believe you have a few more surprises up your sleeve. It ain't over till the fat lady sings. In this case, the fat man. To organize an event of this nature and such scale and magnitude, it would involve a whole host of people. And we need to thank them for such a resounding success. We couldn't have asked for more. Close to 700 people, packed to the rafters, people standing at the back. A beautiful way to start our celebrations. But before I acknowledge a whole host of people who've been working silently behind the scenes, may I, at this moment, recognize the presence of Right Reverend Samuel Joshua. May I request Reverend Rangaya to present a small token. Thank you, Bishop Joshua, for being with us this evening. We are indeed doubly blessed. We also have another midst, the serving bishop in our midst, Right Reverend Bishop Prakash Patole. And Reverend, may I ask you to do the honors again. So let me begin with a list to thank the Right Reverend Avinash Rangaya, our presbyter, the Cathedral Trustees, the Tercentenary Committee, the members of the Cathedral Congregation for their prayers and support and encouragement. Those of you who are planning to leave, you're going to miss a very good surprise. So please be seated. The Cathedral Festival Chorus, which comprises of singers, the choir and congregation of the St. Thomas's Cathedral, organist and choir master Ravi Paul Joshua, the St. Stephen's Church Bandra, Reverend Thomas Jacob and their choir director Vinod Kurian, Christ Church Baikala, Reverend John Silas and Captain Sebastian Anchies, their choir director, the Church of St. Mary the Virgin, Parel Reverend Saji and Mr. John Isaac, choir director, Wilson College of Capella Group and their leader, Joshua Sinate, the Paranjoti Academic Chorus and their director, Mrs. Kumi Wadia, Living Voices and their director, Mrs. Blossom Mendonca. Two, as a token of our appreciation, we like to say it with flowers, and we've got two budding choristers to present the flowers to the festival chorus. I hope Slater can accept it on their behalf. Ladies and gentlemen, Ria and Danica, would you just turn around, please? Ria and Danica, these budding choristers, we are hoping to see them for the 350th centenary celebrations. Thank you. We'd like to thank the man all the way from New York City, our conductor in residence, Joshua Anand Slater. May I request Mr. Yes, why not? Why not? Why not? Why not? Why not? And again, as our token of appreciation, may I request Mr. Solomon Raj, Chairman of the Trustees of the Cathedral, to present these flowers to Joshua Anand Slater. Danica, would you walk up to Mr. Solomon Raj, please? Go up, go ahead. Yes, yes.
Before I hand over the floral tribute to Joshua Anand, I thought of saying a few words about a statement of Archbishop of Canterbury, which he made in a conference of cathedrals in Manchester, UK. He has said that God is of incredible extent until he is bottled up in a cathedral like this. In contrast to this, what we saw today is that those who honor transported us to an oral journey and made us experience the excitement of God in this cathedral, which will be celebrating for 300 years of existence, and stands as witness to the glory of God. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Solomon Raj. Our next person that we'd like to thank is Mr. Ravi Joshua, organist, choir master, Ravi, take a bow. Organist, choir master, and I dare say taskmaster. His untiring efforts, long hours. Being a teacher, he's familiar with the three R's, reading, writing, arithmetic. He's got familiar with another three R's, repairs, restoration, and renovation. Thank you, Ravi. May I request Ria to walk up to Mrs. Meera Isaacs. Mrs. Meera Isaacs, may I request you to kindly present these flowers to Ravi. We'd like to thank all the instrumentalists who played this evening, Mr. Dilip Patil and his team for the recording of this concert, Mrs. Anna Thomas Chacko for her generous gift for the concert outfits, anonymous sponsors for the concert dresses, Mrs. Meera Isaacs, principal of the Cathedral and John Connell School, for making arrangements for Joshua Anand Slater's travel and allowing the use of the school hall for practices. But that's not all. Overseeing restoration, making frequent trips to the cathedral, her eye for detail. I was told just last evening she was here, saw a few spots of paint on the ground and asked the contractor to get it cleaned up for this evening. Chief fundraiser, liaising with the BMC and much more. Thank you ever so much, Mrs. Meera Isaac, for all that you did. Just want to caution you, this is only the first event. We've got many more to go. We're preparing you for the things ahead. Mr. Solomon Raj, the chairman of the Cathedral Trustees, for hosting this evening's dinner for the choir and their families. Sheila, Reuben, and Rebecca Paul for hosting Joshua Anand Slater at their home and making all their travel arrangements. Professor Dr. Kamal Jadhav, for coordinating with the press, the excellent media coverage, coordinating the heritage walk, and also for co-anchoring this evening. A big thank you. If you would take a bow, let them at least see you. Mr. David Sinate for sponsoring the stationery and the music files. If he's the resident conductor, we have a resident photographer, David. Some of the best pictures taken by David. Mrs. Vijaya Lagani for designing the concert dress, Mr. Anthony Gomes of Furtado's for publicizing this concert, Mr. Xerxes Unwala of the NCPA for providing the instrumentalists and the risers. Hey, you need to clap for them. They provided that to you. Mr. Varun Gonsalves for designing the poster for this concert. Our church sextons, Johnson and Prakash, worked so hard behind the scenes. And this name crops up again. Mrs. Sheila Paul and the poor husband languishing in the sidelines for having live streamed this concert, not just in Mumbai, but across the country and the globe as well, through YouTube. Our grateful thanks to Hinduja Media Group in Digital for making this possible. Dr. Laura D'Souza for the air coolers. And of course, this can't be a success unless you have turned up in such large numbers. What an appreciative audience. Would we give them a big hand, please? It ain't over till the fat lady sings. And if you want the fat man, not ready. So over to you, Joshua, if there's something that you want to do for them. That's all. Tell him to do one more. Tell him. He'll do it for you. Are you guys ready? Do the... Yeah, you do that? When the saints, all the saints come marching in? Can we do that again? Are we ready for all... Yeah, please. Ravi.
होगा